think about these topics of grace and forgiveness, it's tempting to say this is maybe something, and we're here on a Sunday, maybe it's just anchored in our faith and moral principles. Because we know, for instance, based upon my faith tradition, that Jesus told us that we'd forgive 70 times 7. So that act of faith, of giving that grace based upon salvation. But I think broader than just the moral principles that guide us across different religions and denominations, it's also the sense of where are we headed? And when I think about that, forgiveness then serves as that base, that first step. And then from there, how do we get to two things, atonement and reconciliation? And when I think about atonement, it's really about how do we repair some of the injuries and wrongs? And that's really an underlying question as we're thinking about Dr. King and racial equality. And he even called us to reconciliation. Once we are able to come together, and you already said it, that listening, that engagement, how can we come together and build a sense of harmony? And those questions are usually different than what we think about as forgiveness. We think about forgiveness as I'm sorry and we move on. Maybe we never speak to each other again. You go right, I go left, somewhere in between. But what are those moments that we can take it as learning and growth and move forward in some constructive ways? Those are different questions.
I love that you said forgiveness can serve at the base, and it's really needed to then branch off and do the other things and move to those higher levels. Tell people about your work trying to stop the school-to-prison pipeline for all kids.
This issue has been near and dear to my heart. Ending the school-to-prison pipeline has been something that has challenged me for at least over a decade. And seeing those early reports, I remember on national news, they had a six-year-old African-American girl being arrested for a temper tantrum. In the middle of it, the officer's taking her out, handcuffs and all, and she's asking for her parents. And you're thinking to yourself, how is she going instead of to the school principal's office and getting her parents and her grandparents involved to the juvenile justice system and leaving her school in a police car? So when I started to think about this, and it goes back to my early years, I trained to become a high school English teacher, so doing student teaching. I had to begin to ponder over the years as an attorney, are we using the tools of incarceration to address other challenges, other social problems? And what other tools are available to us? So I've been really challenged to think about, instead of referring a kid out of the schoolhouse and the school gates into the jailhouse, what other options do we have available? So for me, I always tell my students, we see a problem, we create a solution. My problem was, is this the only tool in our toolbox that we can use to address school disciplinary issues? Or are there other ways that we can bring family, community, and children together in meaningful ways to address school disciplinary issues, but also in engaging in community building and teaching our children basic life skills?
Absolutely. And it is work that you have been doing, and it is not simple work, and you have to continue at it. How do you recommend people keep the stamina to do this work, Dr. Tyner?
Well, any work related to the cause of justice, equality, and freedom, and even democracy building is going to require for all of us to stay focused. Now, first strike against myself, and something that I always have to improve on. You want to work on every issue. You'll see me sometimes, I'm like, oh, now we have to work on environmental justice. Oh my goodness, let's work on this global issue. Oh my, pay equity. But really what I found is it's important to be able to work on key issues and to be able to build the expertise around them. That way you can spend some critical time on developing the solution. It does not mean that you don't work in collaboration with others to address other issues, but it's tempting to be all things to all people. So my work is grounded in two areas, criminal justice and education. Past two decades, those are the issues I'm researching, developing ideas around, changing policies. Because I always tell my students, it's tempting to throw a stone and fight every battle and lose the war. Because if we're looking at our Goliath, Dr. King talked about it as the triple threat of racism, of war, and poverty. We cannot then throw our stones at every issue that comes in front of us. Can we save our energy and all our might to strike down the Goliath of inequity in some meaningful ways? And you cannot do that in taking on every issue.
We're talking with Dr. Artika Tyner. She's a law professor and justice fighter. If you have any questions for her, give us a call or text, 651-989-9226. This listener says, forgiveness generally applies to being wronged or harmed by another person. It is not wrong for your neighbor or family to have a differing political opinion. In this case, I feel that the term and concept of forgiveness is not applied correctly. Well, I think forgiveness has a lot of layers to it. And even if it's because you disagree with a family member or a neighbor, what I'm seeing, Dr. Tyner, is people aren't finding grace. And that's why I started off the show talking about grace. So that if there's no grace, then if a wrong happens, there's no wherewithal to forgive.
I believe that to be true, because oftentimes in the absence of grace, we can't even see each other clearly. And when I say that, it means that, and I always explain this to my students as well, I'm not 100% right. It's not about my opinion. It's not about my belief system. What I'm doing as an educator, what I'm doing as a community member, as a sister, as a friend, as a daughter, is really facilitating and creating opportunities for us all to learn and grow. So for me, a few years ago, I even changed my approach. Everyone walks around, how are you? How's the snow? How's the Vikings? I ask people, what are you reading? That way we can have a concrete conversation about some of the ideas that we can explore together. That way we can get a sense of how can we understand Martin Luther King or his speeches or his ideals. Where do they come from if we've never even read his speeches beyond hearing I Have a Dream? So I'm challenging people that leaders are readers. So how are some ways that we can engage? And I found over the past 6 months joining in with my books for book clubs and engaging people of all different walks of life and belief systems. When we have, and Malcolm X said it best, he gave us a sense of peace for truth no matter whose truth it is. Can we explore that? But we have to have grace and an openness and a willingness to listen and learn to even go on that pursuit to understand truth, to understand our history, and to see each other more clearly.
One thing I didn't mention in your introduction is you are also a children's book author. How can people find your books, Dr. Tyner?
My books can be found on my website, which is my name, ArtikaTyner.com. So ArtikaTyner.
It's been wonderful chatting with you today, and we will have you back. The time always runs so quickly. Really appreciate your insight as we celebrate the history, the legacy, and the work that still needs to be done, that we so connect with Martin Luther King Jr. Appreciate your time today.
Thank you, and thank you as we go along to celebrate this day of service and this rich legacy of servant leadership.
Thank you for what you do. And you can check out a preview of the Comcast special that is featuring Dr. Tyner's work for stopping the school-to-prison pipeline on my Roshini Rajkumar Facebook page. But you can watch it tomorrow, Comcast NBCUniversal Social Justice Series.